been challenged by a community of faith that values and invests in them and ensure that they experience a sense of belonging. I think the key in this piece here is that we value them and that we invest. Meaning that no matter what it takes, we're going to give them every single thing it is they need from a faith perspective in order that they can grow up and be the disciples that the Lord has commissioned them to be. The second one, children should be vital partakers in the life and the ministry of the faith community. I got to go back again and just say that part. Notice it says vital partakers. They can't just be sit and get. They actually have to have an opportunity to participate and take what it is that we teach them and live it out in the world at large. So children should be vital partakers in the life and the ministry of the faith community, where adults invest into them in a variety of ways and settings. Maybe we got to give it to them on a multiplicity of platforms in order that they can get it. The community of faith partners with parents. I'm going to say that part again. The community of faith partners with parents. And that's what we're going to park at today. We're going to be talking about parenting on today. But the community of faith partners with parents because parents are the primary source of nurturing for the faith of a child. Community of faith partners with parents in a mutual effort to raise God-loving and God-fearing children that they are true disciples of Christ and that they will make more disciples. This last one, I must admit, this is not a tagline for recruiting for children's ministry. This is not the best tagline. But it says here, teaching and nurturing the faith formation of children is one of the church's more challenging ministries. And so as we deal with children in the children's ministry, they're in between life and death, and we want to pour the gospel into them. So it's a tough ministry to serve in. Now, we're going to go ahead and get into the word for the day. You can stand for the reading of the word. We're going to be in Hebrews chapter 11 is where we'll start. We're only going to read one verse from Hebrews. It says Hebrews 11, 23 through 29. We're going to read 23. And then we're going to go over to Exodus just for a framework for us. We're going to read Exodus 2, 1 through 10. But let's start with Hebrews 11 and 23. Everybody have it? Is the page still blue? All right. Let's go ahead and read Hebrews 11 and 23. Let's read it carefully. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents. Why? Because they saw he was a beautiful child. And they were not afraid of the king's edict. Now I need you to go to Exodus chapter 2. And again, we're going to read these verses for a framework. Everybody have it. All right, Exodus 2, 1 through 10. Now a man from the house of Levi went and married the daughter of Levi. And the woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was beautiful, she hid him for 3 months. But when she could hide him no longer, she got him a wicker basket and covered it over with tar and pitch. Then she put the children into it and set it among the reeds by the bank of the Nile. And his sister stood at a distance to find out what would happen to him. And the daughter of Pharaoh came down to bathe at the Nile with her maidens walking alongside the Nile. And she saw the basket among the reeds and sent her maid, and she brought it to her. When she opened it up, she saw the child, and behold, the boy was crying. And she had pity on him and said, this is one of the Hebrews' children. Then his sister said to Pharaoh's daughter, check this out, shall I go and call a nurse for you from the Hebrew women, that she may nurse the child for you? And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, go ahead. So the girl went and called the child's mother. And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child away and nurse him for me, and I shall give you your wages. So the woman took the child and nursed him. And then the child grew, and she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. And she named him Moses and said, because I drew him out of the water. You may take a seat. We're going to tag this text as parenting by faith. Parenting by faith. verse 23. In Hebrews 11, verse 23, I want to say this too before I get started going in Hebrews 11, 23. Paul Tripp says this about parenting. He says, parenting is either a thing of the highest treasure to you, and that is demonstrated in your choices, in your words, and in your actions every day, or either it's not. So either we have parenting on a high scale of value, or we have parenting on a low scale of value, or somewhere in between. But the question is, if parenting is not at a high scale of value, then the question is, are we giving our kids everything it is they need to survive in a world in which wants to influence them to not follow the will, the way, and the word of God? So, we're going to see in 11 and 23, our first point that we want to make is that parent with faith is your perspective. Again, I'll say again, parent with faith is your perspective. And when we mean perspective, we're talking about how you get that call from the teacher and they call you about five times. is to jump on his son and cover his son in order that his son does not get hit by the bullets that are flying. So the question is for us is, how are we protecting our children? And where is our protection radar? And then, Pastor Ron, how do you see that in the text? Let's look at it in Hebrews 11 and 23. It says, by faith, Moses, when he was born, he was hidden for 3 months. Why was he hidden? He was hidden because the king had lashed out that law that saying, hey, you got to throw all the babies in the Nile River. But his parents did not, they were not afraid of what the king issued out. They were more concerned about what God considered as important and what God valued. And at that moment, they made the decision to protect their son. So my question to you is what do our kids need protection from? Our kids need protection from secular culture. I said it on last week. There are influences that are in the atmosphere coming through the television waves and through the radio waves in which our kids have easy access to on the internet and on all social media that want to influence them away from God versus going towards God. So we have to have our protection radar up in order to protect our kids just like Amram and Jacob did. It did not matter what the world thought. They did what was right in God's eyesight, and that was to protect the child. Now, in them protecting the child, you've got to understand that their very lives were being put on the line. Would you put your very life on the line for the sake of your kid? Would you sacrifice the time that is needed in order to invest in the child to ensure that they are discipled in a proper way? There's also the issue that we got to understand that our children are going to entertain relationships. And I love how Corinthians says that bad company corrupts good character. We need to keep our kids away from certain people. We need to keep our kids away from certain relationships, because those relationships want to do nothing but drain our kids of all of the stuff that we pour into them. So the question is, again, where is our protection radar? Are we willing to put ourselves on the line just like this father did for his son? Now, I failed to mention one piece in part, and the father ended up by protecting his son. He ended up losing his life. Now, that sounds like Jesus-like mentality, because Jesus gave his life for the sake of us. So the same way that Jesus gave his life for us, we ought to give our lives for the sake of children in order that they can grow up and be every single thing that God has called them to be. So again, in order to parent with faith, we got to protect our children. There are so many things that want to influence them. I mentioned this in the last service. There's a young lady by the name of Monet. She's a singer. And Monet is a singer, and she's a very popular singer. She recently just came out and said that she's now categorizing herself as what's called a pansexual. If you don't know what pansexual is, go Google that. Go Google it. Find out what that means. But she said that she wanted to identify herself this way from a sexual perspective in order that young boys and girls can know that they can go with any preference that they want regarding their sexuality, and they don't have to be ashamed. Now, that type of mindset, that type of stuff, that's what's out there trying to influence our babies and capture them and enslave them to a mindset that has nothing to do with what God has laid out as a prescription for them. The world wants to take away the God identity and replace it with the devil's identity. So we got to make sure that we are on God, we are on tap, we are on call, we are on post, making sure that our kids are not falling prey to the world. Now, I don't know if you remember this movie right here. Y'all remember this movie right here? Yeah, I love cartoons, all right? I love this cartoon. Mom is the father. Nemo the son. And constantly over and over again would tell Nemo, don't go out there. Don't go out there. One day Nemo, like, man, I had enough. You embarrassed me. You know, sometimes embarrassed our kid. You embarrassed me. So despite the fact that Mama tells him not to go out there, Nemo makes the decision to go out there anyway. And when Nemo goes out there anyway, the danger that his father was trying to warn him about got a hold of him. And so, guys, if we put ourselves in the same position as Marlon, sometimes you have done every single thing
just relied on God to fill in the blanks for what it was that she didn't totally understand on how to deal with, and she places him by the bank of the Nile. And when she places him by the bank of the Nile, it's interesting to me that his sister Miriam makes the decision to go and see what was going to happen with baby Moses. When she goes to go and see what happens with baby Moses, you just got to see the hand of God, because the name of God is not mentioned, but you see the hand of God all in the story. So you see Miriam goes to go and see what's going to happen to her baby brother. And so It's